Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining early. Good afternoon, Senator Cardin.
Lydia, how are you?
Fine, thanks. How are you today?
Oh, doing great.
We'll trickle in and I'll also.
Hi, Ken. It's good to see you. Carlton, I get to see my staff. I don't see my staff that frequently, so it's nice to see my staff people. It's nice to see all of you here. And we got Congressman Sarbanes. Good to see you.
And Congressman Sarbanes, you'll see a request to be unmuted. Let's try this again for you. See a request on your screen to be unmuted. There we go.
There we go. Senator, how are you doing today? Good to be with you.
I'm doing well. Doing better than I should, I guess, right now. Everything seems to be nice. Beautiful day outside.
Temperature's going back up, unfortunately.
But the cicadas are leaving, although there were a lot of them out this morning when I was walking.
I think they're peaking right now.
Oh. It's time for them to go take a 17-year rest.
And Senator and Congressman Sarbanes, we are live with everyone, and we'll get started right at 1:30 if that works for you all.
Sounds good.
Wonderful. Thank you, everyone, for joining early. Feel free to leave your camera on so the senator and the congressman can see you. And welcome to you, Mr. Umberger. We'll be with you in a moment. You should have seen a request to be unmuted on your screen, and welcome to the call.
Hi, Steve.
Good afternoon. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
We hear you fine.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Steve, before we get started, are you getting a lot of calls in regards to the shuttered venues, or is that an area that you're getting concerned about what's happening?
We're getting a few, and yeah, yes, to answer the question, but we're restaurant, RRF, restaurant revitalization has been a hot topic as well as idle.
Okay.
But yes.
We'll cover both of those. I'm talking with the administrator later today in regards to the shuttered venues, so. There seems to have been some hiccups on that program.
Good.
All right. Well, if it works for you, Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarbanes, and Mr. Umberger, I'll get started with our introduction. All right. Welcome, everyone, to the virtual conversation with U.S. Senator Ben Cardin, U.S. Congressman John Sarbanes, and the small business community. This is a one-hour event. We will hear remarks from Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarbanes, and Mr. Steve Umberger. And then we will open up the floor for questions and answers. Feel free to leave your camera on so that the Senator, the Congressman, and Mr. Umberger can see you. And just to note, this event is open to the press and it is being recorded, and we wanted everyone to know that. When we get to the question and answer portion, please raise your hand through WebEx if you have a question, and I'll request to unmute you so that you're able to speak. If you do not get a chance to ask a question, please email us at smallbusiness@cardin.senate.gov. I'll be sure to put that in the chat for you all. You can also go on Congressman Sarbanes' website, which is sarbanes.house.gov, and that will also be in the chat for everyone. So let's get started with opening remarks from you, Senator Cardin. Over to you.
Lydia, thank you very much for working out the logistics so we all could meet via the internet. I know Congressman Sarbanes and I are looking forward to the day that we'll be able to do this in person. We're almost there. But you got to stay strong in getting COVID-19 behind us. So thank you for joining us. It's a pleasure to be with my congressman. I want to thank Congressman Sarbanes for joining us today. I can tell you, we, the Cardin household, feel like we're very well represented in the Congress of the United States and the leadership that Congressman Sarbanes has been playing on so many important issues related to our economy, related to our environment, and related to the basic fundamental protections of our democratic institutions. So I'm glad to be with him today as we can talk about what we're doing for small business and what is likely to occur as far as many of the programs that we have to help small businesses in our community. We are joined by Steve Umberger, who is the Baltimore Region Director of the Small Business Administration. So we have the expert on how the programs are being administered on this call, and he certainly will be able to give you information and respond to some of your questions. Let me just make a few brief remarks. Let me also introduce, if I might, Carlton Atkinson, who's my state director, who's on the call, Ken Reichert, who handles my transactions in the Washington suburbs, and I think they're the two staff people that I have that are on the call, along with Lydia, who made all of our arrangements. Let me just give you just some brief status updates as to where we are in regards to small businesses. As a result of COVID-19, an unprecedented amount of new help was provided to small businesses in our community. In total, over $1 trillion was made available by Congress to help small businesses get through COVID-19. By far, the largest single program was the Paycheck Protection Program, PPP, which in total now has given approximately 11.7 million small businesses forgivable loans to the tune of $795 billion. This program is now closed. They're still processing some of the loans, and there are some issues that may still need congressional attention in regards to the Paycheck Protection Program. But the program has been pretty much utilized. Obviously, loans are still outstanding. There's still a forgiveness process. But as far as new loans are concerned, none are being taken. The Economic Injury Disaster Loan Program was made available for COVID-related disasters and has provided over $3.8 million of loans to the tune of over $200 billion on EIDL loans. That program is still up and running, so that's an available program, as well as the EIDL Advance Program, which are grants that are given up to $10,000 to smaller small businesses that have eligibility due to revenue loss, and it can be up to $15,000. There can be a second round. There are funds available for these programs. So if you have suffered significant revenue losses and you fall within the characterization of being in low-income communities, you can qualify for an EIDL advance. The debt relief program is coming to an end. It provided up to 6 months of debt relief on 7A and 504 loans. That program is coming to an end. There are two programs that are up and running. One is the Restaurant Act that provides help for revenue losses to restaurants. That has been oversubscribed. Over 300,000 applications have been received to the tune of the total dollars that are available of $28.6 billion. It's been oversubscribed by about $40 or $50 billion. And that's an issue that Congress will need to take up as to whether they're going to put more money into that program. The initial processing are for women-owned, veteran-owned, and economically and socially disadvantaged-owned small businesses, but all are eligible for the restaurant program. And then the Shuttered Venue Program, which helps our museums, our entertainment centers, our movie houses, that program is now being ready to process loans, grants, and we expect that there's sufficient funds to cover the 11,000 applications that have been received under the Shuttered Venue Program. That's just a quick overview. I want to put this in context. Congressman Sarbanes and I are working with the Biden administration on Building Back Better, which means that we I've already done the American Rescue Plan, which included improvements for small businesses. In that, the most important things to get COVID-19 behind us, the best thing we can do to help our economy is to get the pandemic behind us. And the American Rescue Plan provided significant resources for vaccine distribution. One plea I hope all of us in our leadership and our community urges all eligible people who are not vaccinated, that don't have a medical reason against vaccination, to get vaccinated immediately. It's important for their own safety, but it's also important for our community and get our economy back on track. As we consider the American Jobs Plan, there will be additional provisions in for small business. I am working closely with the Biden administration and with my House counterparts in improvements of the current tools that are available under the Small Business Administration to help target those to those small businesses that really need the help, those that are in underserved communities, those that are owned by minorities, women-owned small businesses, and those who have suffered the most losses, to try to tailor a program that can help them. So we're looking at fine-tuning the current tools that are under the Small Business Administration, as well as new programs, the legislation that I have filed that includes venture capital, includes partnerships with minority institutions, includes programs that can help fine-tune the small business programs. I hope we can get into discussion on that. And with that, let me turn it over to my colleague, my friend, and my congressman, Congressman John Sarbanes.
Thanks very much, Senator. Appreciate this opportunity to partner on behalf of our small businesses out there in the community. Of course, I represent the 3rd District, not the entire state as you do, but there's a real overlap of business interests in the 3rd District that are participating on this call today. And I want to thank everybody for taking the opportunity to join this discussion about what we have been doing and what we continue to try to do on behalf of the small businesses in our community in Maryland, of course, across the country. I want to first salute you for soldiering through, all the businesses that are on the call today, soldiering through this very, very difficult time. In many ways being kind of an inspiration for the broader community in the ways that you've found to try to get through and pass this pandemic. Obviously, many have suffered. I mean, the statistics on businesses that have had to close, particularly our smallest businesses across the country, are quite staggering. But then there are millions, obviously, who have survived and have found a way to continue to push forward. And many are represented on the call today. So I want to thank you for that. Certainly, Senator Cardin, given his role and responsibility in the Senate when it comes to small businesses, has given you a very good overview. I just wanted to emphasize a couple of things. Over the last year and a half, as we've met the challenge of this pandemic, the response when it comes to our businesses has been a combination of trying to strengthen existing pipelines and resources that and supports that are available for small businesses. In other words, things that would exist in, quote, normal times, just making sure that they were fortified. But obviously, in the emergency situation that we faced, there were many programs stood up for the first time to address the particular crisis that we were in. So that combination of strengthening what was there before, that kind of infrastructure to support our businesses, and then developing some new responses, I think, is what has allowed us to provide a robust set of supports to small businesses over the last 16 months, which has been really, really critical. We're blessed to have with us today Steve Umberger from the Baltimore Small Business Administration office, and he's going to give you a little bit more on the specifics of what's now available as we move forward, because we're kind of in that transitional stage. But let me just observe for a moment how critically important it was that we were hearing from you directly from small businesses throughout the state of Maryland, of course, across the country, that we were hearing from those who represent small businesses like our chambers of commerce, who I know are represented on the call today, about what you were facing, because that helped us to build the response that was reflected in the CARES Act, which was the first major response to the crisis of the pandemic, as well as what went into the annual budget to support small businesses, and of course, the American Rescue Plan. The dollars that we directed, and Senator Cardin talked about the size and scale of the response, coming from Washington was unprecedented, really. But it's just as important that we are listening carefully to make sure that the dollars that are going out the door from Washington are finding their way to the businesses that we are intending to help. And it doesn't always work out perfectly. We saw there were glitches in the CARES program. We heard from small businesses, including the smallest businesses out there. And we responded by trying to strengthen what was in the American Rescue Plan. And actually, Senator Cardin was really at the center of a lot of that effort to make sure the dollars were getting where they needed to go. So this has to be an ongoing conversation. That's really what today is about. If you see problems, if the dollars that a particular program is supposed to bring to you or those supports, it's not happening the way it should, we need to hear that so we can go back in with our toolkit and try to make sure that it's working as well as it can. So great to be with you. Looking forward to the conversation. Now, I'm very pleased to turn it over to a terrific partner for us in the delegation, for sure, but certainly for the business community and small business community in the state of Maryland, Steve Umberger. Steve?
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much, Congressman Sarbanes and Senator Cardin. It's a great pleasure to be here. And, you know, thank you. I can't thank you enough for all your support throughout. It's been really challenging times for all of us, whether it be folks at the SBA or the congressional delegation, and in particular, absolutely the small business and the small business owners. Appreciate you giving me a few minutes here to get some update and also talk about a couple of the programs that we have ongoing. We know the American Rescue Plan of 2021 brought back the Paycheck Protection Program, which was a success previously. Ran out of funding, but then with the new appropriation, I would just give you the Maryland numbers since you heard the overall numbers. 111,000 loans for over $5 billion have gone to small businesses since the beginning of this year, 2021, with the resurrection of the Paycheck Protection Program. That's significant. Economic injury disaster loans, the EIDL program, since the inception back in April of 2020, provided 69,314 Maryland small businesses with over $3.77 billion. The long-term low interest loans have been very valuable and come in handy to a number of folks. Although it's debt, it's still 30-year term, long-term low interest, and excuse me, with the forbearance and payments for 24 months, it's still a pretty good deal, even though it's debt. That program remains open through the end of this fiscal year, or no, this calendar year, December 31st. And anybody interested in learning more or going online and making an application, it's www.sba.gov. The Restaurant Revitalization Program, or Fund, launched earlier this year. Within the first 2 weeks, as the Senator said, 300,000 applications. It was actually over $75 billion. So that fund is underfunded, if you will, or will be exhausted soon, but the dollars are currently going out and hitting the bank accounts of food and hospitality businesses that have suffered greatly over this past year. We do continue to accept applications for the Shuttered Venue Operator Grant. The audience there, movie theaters, concert halls, large gathering venues. Again, a population that was clearly devastated by this pandemic. a couple items that we haven't talked about yet, but I want to make sure to thank Senator Cardin for all his hard work on. It was about, I guess we're into the second year now. The Women Business Center was brought back to Baltimore, was brought back to Salisbury, a long time Maryland, in my district anyway, which is the state of Maryland outside of Prince George's and Montgomery counties. We had a very large need for this particular entity, and the senator and his hard work, he was very instrumental in bringing that Women Business Center back to Baltimore and back to Maryland, the two of them. Also, within the last month, another long fought battle, not necessarily battle, but we again want to thank Senator Cardin for his hard work and making sure that Maryland became the home to the new Veteran Business Outreach Center. This grant funded opportunity closed, oh, I want to say 2 weeks ago. And me and my staff, we're working closely with the new director there, trying to find a venue, and we want to get that up and running as soon as possible. The center will be a storefront opportunity for veterans, their families, military individuals that are transitioning back to civilian life after putting theirs on the line for us and serving their country. And this is a long overdue resource that we now will have in Maryland. And me and my team, we're going to make sure that, along with our other resource partners, it becomes a huge success and good opportunity for the military and veteran community. One item that has recently launched that is pending a funding opportunity, grant funding opportunity, is the new Community Navigators Pilot Program. This initiative again was as a result of the American Rescue Plan passed earlier this year, and will take on a form of technical assistance directly to the communities. It'll operate under a hub and spoke model, the hub being the awardee, the grant awardee, who will then reach out and collaborate with many local entities, pre-existing entities that are in the community, understand the cultures. The whole idea here is to focus energy to those that may have not been able to obtain technical business assistance previously in underserved markets, women, veteran business, you know, those type of communities, and by providing the service through individuals and entities that are already located there. So that funding opportunity, you can find out more at sba.gov again, or at grants.gov, where the notice of funding opportunity is posted. So that's quite a bit of quite a few things that we have going on. Some are somewhat in the past and yet to be funded. With the Restaurant Revitalization Fund, we may have some other good news. We're hoping for that. There's still a great need there. We just want to let you know that we are here, my small office in Baltimore. Everyone's working remotely now. There's 15 of us total. You can reach us by phone at 410-962-6195 or email at Baltimore_DO, as in district office, at sba.gov. So just let me thank Senator Cardin and Congressman Sarbanes again for rolling up your sleeves, staying the course, and making sure that Maryland entrepreneurs have access to the resources and opportunities that foster success. So thank you.
We'll turn it back to Lydia for questions or comments.
Yes, thank you, Senator Cardin. Thank you, Congressman Sarbanes and Mr. Umberger. So everyone, we've reached the question and answer portion of our call today. I wanted to let you know, hopefully you can hear me. When I unmute you, you will see a request to be unmuted on your screen. And if you're looking to see how you can raise your hand through WebEx, On the bottom right-hand corner of your screen, there will be a participants button. And if you hit on that button and search your name on the participants list and you hover your mouse over that, you will see how to raise your hand. And if you're unable to do that, feel free to chat me and I can call on you as well. All right, and please also, when you ask your question, state your name and your affiliation and state who your question is for, whether that be Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarbanes, or Mr. Umberger. So let's see if we have any questions coming in. All right, the first question will come from Anwar Masoud, and please correct me if I'm pronouncing that wrong. I will request to unmute you now, Anwar.
Thank you so much, Senator Cardin, Congressman, and Mr. Umberger. My question is, I have a pediatrics practice in Clarksburg and Montgomery Village, two offices. We were having a decent gross revenue, and I had loans with M&T Bank. So the people stopped bringing their kids to our office. We got the PPP loans twice. We kept the staff. Everything was working fine. But then my revenue dropped from 2.5 to 1.96. And the numbers at the bank changed. So M&T basically, well, I don't want to use the word, but harassed me. That your revenue is low now low and your loans are due. Like she said something which is not legal, that you sell your house, you sell your things, but return our money. When the other bank people said no, that is not right. She was went beyond. So my problem is I have loans and I don't have patience. They're coming in, trickling in slowly back. But there's no fault of mine. I cannot let go my staff because July, August, they're gonna come back. So what am I supposed to do? So is there a debt relief or a disaster loan? I have talked to Congressman Trone, his office. They're helping me. I have talked to the SBA office. They're helping, they're very helpful people. So my thing is, okay, no fault of mine, my revenue dropped. Is there something for me?
Anwar, let me just acknowledge that there is a tool. The main tool would be the EIDL loan program, the Economic Injury Disaster Loan Program. If you have not gotten that, you can get both the EIDL loan and PPP. So you've taken advantage of the two rounds of PPP, so there's no longer any forgivable 7A loans that are still available. The challenge with the EIDL program is that it's not a challenge, is that there is a qualification. You have to send in your forms. It's a formula as to how much the loan will be, and we can help you in making sure you complete those loan documents. But that's a 30-year low interest, up to 30-year low interest loans that would be, I would assume, a more manageable situation than your current arrangement with your bank. So you should check that out to see whether that will work. And the EIDL loan program is still open till the end of the year. So that's available. But it's a formula program based upon your application as to how much you are able to borrow, but it does include working capital.
And Steve Umberger would have a better sense of this probably, but I do think there's some extra layers, as Senator Cardin said. There's a targeted advanced EIDL program that is actually based in terms of eligibility on specific reductions in your revenues over a certain period of time. So those were put in place for the express reason that we knew there were businesses whose revenues would drop precipitously and that they ought to be getting special attention.
Thank you, Congressman. The next question will come from Leonardo McLarty. I'll request to unmute you now, Mr. McLarty.
Thank you, and good afternoon, excuse me, Congressman Sarbanes and Senator Cardin. So my question is actually for the SBA rep, and The question actually applies to my chamber, but I would imagine there are small business people that this would apply to as well. And that is ultimately, we had applied for an EIDL loan, I guess it was last fall, and ultimately, you know, have yet to receive a yes or a no. And so I'm ultimately at this point, I'm fine with the no, but it's the limbo piece that I guess, you know, trying to figure out any direction. I've called a few times, sent emails, and as well as leveraged other contacts. And so I'm just curious, are there other situations just where people aren't, you know, it's been now some, I guess we're June, some maybe 8 months or so, 9 months, where people just haven't been given a yes or no answer?
Leonardo, I would have to probably talk to you offline, but yes, there are a number of individuals, business owners, businesses that have applied for EIDL that, not that they haven't heard anything, so I'm a little surprised that maybe through the portal that you didn't get email notifications of acceptance or what have you, but it's a sheer matter of volume, and I can't, you know, we don't handle those locally, but we can certainly look into individual cases and get further details to see if there's something holding it up that maybe you should have been aware of or made aware of, but weren't. So let's get in touch if we could to find out the particulars, and I'll check it out for you.
All right, I'm going to unmute you now, Mr. McLarty, so you can respond.
Going to say, I can't unmute. I was just going to ask, what's the best way for me to reach out to you?
I'll tell you what, I'll reach out to you afterwards. How's that?
Okay.
I have good. Your email.
All right, thank you.
Good.
Thank you. So our next question is from Mr. Paul Bardock, and I'll request to unmute you now.
Thank you so much, Senator, Congressman. Not so much a question, just something I want to share with our audience today. The Maryland Small Business Development Center, which is based in College Park and which has offices throughout the state, is also an important resource to help business owners survive and even thrive during this troubled time. We do this through intensive one-on-one consulting with the business owner, and when appropriate, through group training. So to connect with our SBDC staff closest to where you work or live, please log into www.marylandsbdc, that's MarylandSBDC, www.marylandsbdc.org, and we'll be pleased to work with you. By logging on through that website, you'll be routed to the right person there to help you. So thank you. I did want to make that announcement. No question, but I did want everyone to know about the service that we have, thanks in large part to the senator and the congressman. Also want to thank Steve Umberger for doing a great job being our partner and helping guide this organization. So thanks to you also, Steve.
Thanks, Paul.
So let me just thank the SBDC and what you do, your incredibly important service. Congressman Sarbanes said it best, when the small businesses are the growth engine of our economy, that's where more private sector employment is created than in large companies. You're innovative. You even found out ways to survive COVID-19 by developing new ways to deliver your products and services during the pandemic. But you don't have large staffs to work through the bureaucracies of government programs. And you don't have large bank accounts that can handle you during rough economic times. So that's the reason why we provided this level of attention to small businesses, but we also recognize you need help in finding out how you can get the help that you are entitled to. And that's why we think that small business development centers are so vitally important. Steve mentioned the women's business centers or the veterans outreach offices. All those are important. And also the Navigator program. The Community Navigator program was a priority of President Biden. These grants are now going out with community organizations that will establish contacts for small businesses to be able to connect them to the programs that are available. So we're going to do as much outreach as we can in order to help you navigate what is available to help you, recognizing you do not have the capacity on staff to have the type of support that can, on your own, marshal through the different types of federal programs.
Let me just add, there's, as we can see from the conversation and what's been presented, there's a tremendous amount of resources out there for small businesses. Sometimes the challenge is just finding your way to them. Sometimes the challenge is not knowing where to start. In other words, appreciating that there are a lot of different resources, but which is the best one for you? And what I would say there is, all of these various resource centers, for the most part, certainly if they're in the state of Maryland or from the central Maryland region, they are networked with each other. So you have to be 100% sure that a particular group or resource or, you know, workforce development center or business center is the exact right fit for you. Reach out anyway, because they're going to know whether the fit is there or whether there's another organization or center that you can be directed to. They are very well sort of aligned fashion. So I definitely encourage people to reach out in any direction, because you will ultimately get to a place that I think can provide some good advice and counsel.
We'll move on to our next question, which will be from Gail Furman. I'll request to unmute you now, Gail Furman.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarbanes, Mr. Umberger. All your dedicated work throughout the pandemic has been greatly appreciated by all small businesses and main streets throughout the country. I have a couple questions for you. Number one, I am a restaurant owner, severely impacted, just like every other restaurant owner throughout the country in regards to this. What we would like to know is, have the funds been fully exhausted as of today with all of the minority-owned businesses, or are you starting to process on the other businesses that have applied to this? That's number one. And number two, Senator Cardin, I know that the Senate has put information into put more funds into this act. Do you have any idea if and when that might take place? Thank you.
Well, in regards to the processing, if Steve, if you have more information than I do, please come forward. My understanding is that in the priority 21-day processing, there is more applications than there are resources, or they would use just about all the resources. And that therefore they are not processing, they're taking but not processing those that do not fall into the priority 21-day. And it's women-owned, veteran-owned, and economically and socially disadvantaged small businesses. They're the three categories that fall into the 21-day priority. I announced early that I support putting more money into this program. I chair the Small Business and Entrepreneurship Committee. So I've been meeting with the Biden administration and with the leader's office in regards to the opportunities to advance additional funding for this program. There are two areas that I think we should put more money into the programs. One is the restaurant program, because it's oversubscribed. The other are the self-employed on the second round of PPP, or initial rounds, where they changed the calculation on the amount of the loans, and it was not made retroactive. I think it should have been made retroactive, so I'm trying to do something about helping those that have non-conventional type employment so that they can get full advantage of the PPP loans. In both of those categories, we are attempting to put more money into the program. The good news that both of these are bipartisan. The restaurant fund was created with an initiative by both Democrats and Republicans, so it's not a partisan issue. And I think Senator Schumer, the majority leader of the Senate, is trying to work with his Republican counterpart to see whether there's a bipartisan path forward to do this in an expedited way. If not, we will have to look for it in the American Jobs Plan or in the appropriation process to put more money into the programs.
And if I can add just one little note on numbers, there have been right around 100,000 restaurant revitalization fund approvals granted to date. And that does exhaust the funding, the 28.6 billion. So there's still a need out there and we will see what the future holds. But the money is being dispersed, distributed into the bank accounts. To the extent of which those 100,000 have been dispersed, I can't tell you, but it is going out.
But Steve, my understanding is I think all that was in the priority category. I think it was all in the women-owned, veteran-owned, or socially or economically disadvantaged small businesses.
The bulk of it was. I heard something earlier today. I don't have the exact breakdown, but there was about 10% of it that went to other.
Oh, outside?
No. So there was about 90, a little bit around 90% or maybe a little bit over 90% of the funds went to the priority categories, yes, or is going to.
One thing I'd ask the participants on the call, particularly the restaurants that are represented, is please share your experience, maybe through the local chambers that you work with or with a restaurant group that you're part of. Not just the burden that's fallen on you and maybe the continuing pressures you face, but if some of these programs like the Restaurant Revitalization Fund were extremely helpful to you in getting through a difficult time, those are stories that are going to help Senator Cardin and myself and other members of Congress go find other rounds of support for programs like this. As the senator said, that particular effort was a bipartisan one from the outset. So if we can point to accounts beyond just how, you know, these things get oversubscribed, which shows the need, but exactly what it looks like, how those dollars came in and what it meant in terms of the practical dimension of keeping your business open, your restaurant working. We need to gather those stories up to make the case for future funding to support these efforts. So that would be very helpful to us as a delegation to get that that kind of perspective.
Thank you, Congressman. The next question will be from Esther P. I'll request to unmute you now, Esther. I'm just requesting to unmute you again. There we go.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Senator Cardin and Senator Silverins. Thank you. I want to first thank you, Congressman, about calling the VA for me. I had an indirect interaction with you was a couple of months ago. So thank you for your staffers helping me with my veterans issues. I'm coming from Congressional District 13. San Francisco Bay Area as a past commissioner on housing and redevelopment, on veterans affairs, and on women and LGBTQ. I've been here in Baltimore County for about 18 months, and I really kind of want to leave this question open about some concerns. First, I have contacted the SBDC offices for veteran support. There is an issue right now that I've been experiencing as a veteran here in Baltimore County accessing the SBA back in 2019. It was in Towson. As a community and economic developer for low-income communities, I am trying to understand or maybe see if the SBA could do more grass outreach at the BCCC and further into the communities for people like me who have accessibility issues. The second thing that I have concern is when the PPE loans were given out, the majority of Black businesses that got that money were churches and organizations. So I would like to know from the SBA and from Senator Cardin, what can we do more demographically to Baltimore County and ensure that people like me And as a minority disabled veteran business enterprise can get more wraparound service. And then the other issues, I will talk to the SBA directly offline. Thank you.
In regards to the fairness of the distributions of the PPP funds, we recognize that because we're using commercial lenders, these are forgivable 7A loans that are given by commercial lenders, that there would be a concern about underbanked communities. So we included language in the original bill in the CARES Act that required the SBA to do special outreach to the underbanked communities. Unfortunately, they did not do that under the previous administration. And the Inspector General made that finding in the report. So as we replenish the funds in the PPP program, and as we changed and provided additional help, we took more direct action, including requiring a certain amount of the loans be given out through mission lenders, the CDFIs, the minority depository institutions. We walled off a certain amount of money that had to go for priority loans in underserved communities. We made special consideration for smaller small businesses because they're generally much more representative of minority communities and underbanked communities. And the results have been very impressive. The first round of PPP, those loans that were made in 2020, reflect exactly your concerns were not met. But the more recent loans that have been given out are much more directed towards the underserved community, traditionally underserved communities. So we've done much better as the program has developed. Under the Biden administration, he made priority dates for underserved communities. He's had exclusive opportunities. And as we looking at the American Jobs Plan and redefining and modifying the existing tools under the SBA, every one of our initiatives is to provide more money to traditionally underserved communities. I have a bill, the Uplift Bill, that works with HBCUs and MDIs to have partnerships to develop incubators and accelerator programs. We have a program for venture capital that would go to underserved communities. So we are looking at modifying the tools using the Community Advantage 7A loan that reaches more of the underserved communities, the microloans. All those we're looking at fine tuning in order to be fair. We recognize what you're saying is being very accurate, and we are very much committed to making sure that we correct that.
And just to add very quickly to what Senator Cardin said, at the outset, I spoke about how this pandemic forced us to look at existing infrastructure for delivering support to communities, small businesses out there, strengthen those and develop new ones that didn't exist. In theory, there's been the opportunity to distribute loans and financial assistance through things like community development financial institutions, minority depository institutions, and others that can get to the smallest businesses. But the fact of the matter is that they really didn't have the support and strength behind them that they need, not just in the pandemic, where there was an effort to really strengthen that connective tissue to the community, but now going forward, we have a great opportunity to take the increased utilization we've seen of some of these pipelines and make it permanent. And if we do that, I think we can address the issues of fairness and equity that the senator just referred to. The other thing is the Community Navigator program that Steve talked about is an example of really getting granular and being able to reach out and help bring people, match them to the opportunities, resources, and information that they need. And I think applications for that, correct me if I'm wrong, Steve, but can come in up through July 12th. Of this year. And so organizations on the call here who could be a site community navigator program or be involved with it otherwise, please take advantage of that opportunity.
And thank you for that, Congressman. The community navigator program is clearly targeted to the communities that the lady is indicated, and it's open to state, local, nonprofits, state and local entities, nonprofits, just about anybody, SBDC, SCORE, Women Business Center, Veteran Business Opportunity Center, any chamber, anyone can apply and become a hub, which would be the focal point for the community and getting the outreach into the community.
Thank you, Mr. Umberger. The next question will be from Mr. Henson, or Z Henson. I'll request to unmute you now.
Hi, my name is Vincent Huang, and I am a CEO from a small business by the name Precise Software Solutions. I want to first thank you all, Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarban, and Administrator Umberg for everything that you have done to support the small business community impacted by the pandemic. Senator Cardin, I also wanted to thank you for recognizing us as the U.S. Senate Small Business of the Week in 2019. So my question is not necessary on pandemic relief, but rather promoting entrepreneurship. I graduated from UMBC, and I have the honor to serve on the school's advisory board. My personal mission there is to promote entrepreneurship among the student community. Now, on a few occasions, I have shared my limited knowledge to the school, to the students especially, on what the help is out there based on my personal experience. I have got so much support from the SBA, including the 8A Business Development Program. Now, the question I have is, if there is a more systematic and informal way to introduce the resources that can help the students learn and build up their entrepreneurship experience. It sounds like SBDC might be a good starting point, but I wanted to see if there is a kind of broader guidance I can take it back to the student community.
Well, thank you for that question. I don't know if we have a specific game plan in regards to our universities, but it's something we should be talking about. Entrepreneurship allows for wealth development, it allows for economic progress for our country, and it has not been equal in all communities. When you take a look at the current SBA tools and the number of women-owned participant businesses, the number of minority-owned participating businesses, you find that there's a big gap. And the best place to deal with this is on our campuses, than what you do, and that we should be encouraging that. And I'd be certainly willing to work with you to see whether we can provide some specific type of guidance as to how we can help. The SBDCs may be a good place to start, and we'll work with you in that regard. I do want to point out that we do have programs that are aimed at correcting some of these inequities. When we take a look at the emerging markets, for example, with venture capital. Venture capital is the worst as far as fair distributions. There's almost zero venture capital going to minority-owned small businesses. It's less than 3%. And so we really want to set up, and I believe this is going to happen, an office within the SBA to work on emerging markets and venture capital, as well as to partner with incubators and accelerators, which could work on UMBC's campus. So there's some things that we could do working with you that might be able to help you get some of the resources. I must tell you, with Freeman Hrabowski, you got the number one educational leader in regards to opportunities. So I have a lot of confidence at UMBC.
Senator Cardin, a moment ago, that the American Jobs Plan that President Biden has put forward is an opportunity to strengthen these incubators, innovation hubs. Clearly, universities would be right at the center of that effort, making sure that the knowledge transfer and application of knowledge that you're referring to can happen as efficiently as possible. And we know that Maryland is a place that should be one of the leading regions in the country when you look at all the assets that we have here and so many critical industries, building that, again, using the phrase connective tissue, back to the universities and to students, I think is critical. So thank you for making that observation.
Thank you, Congressman. The next question is from John Shields, and I'll request to unmute you now, John. I'll request to unmute you again, and hopefully this time it works. There we go.
Hi there. I'm John Shields. I'm the owner of Gertrude's Restaurant at the Baltimore Museum. And I want to thank Senator Cardin and Congressman Sarbanes so much for everything that you've done already through the CARES Act and the American Rescue Plan for small businesses. And obviously, you know, my focus is on restaurants. And some of the programs have been instrumental. They kept us in business. They really, really did. The EIDL, PPP, the first PPP, kept Gertrude's open. Otherwise, gone. And our restaurant, as so many, are a huge part of the community. You know, we have a big role to play throughout the community. And what I was here and what I wanted to come and talk just quickly today was about the state of the restaurants right now. You know, the pandemic seems to be winding down, but there's a tremendous amount of suffering in the restaurant industry right now. The PPP was great. We applied for one, we got that. Two, we applied when it first started in January. And we still haven't heard anything yet, even though we check on almost a daily or weekly basis and we get no response. And then I'd also like to say to Steve Umberger, thank you so much. The SBA did a phenomenal job with the Restaurant Restoration Fund. All the lead up to it, there were webinars, there was information, it was very clear. We did all the homework. We got it in 25 minutes after the portal opened. But as we all heard, the money ran out pretty quickly. And so myself and many other restaurateurs that I know, we're hoping and praying that some more funding goes into that, because it really is one of the things that will keep us going. Because when I'm saying that the pandemic's not over, you've all read everywhere about staffing shortages. We can't get help. We can't get reopened. We have days of the week that were closed. I just had to shut down another half of a shift because we just don't have anyone to work. We also, you know, it's a supply demand. So we've increased wages, you know, over like 20%. But that puts a lot of stress. We've already lost hundreds of thousands of real dollars. And prices, if anyone's seen, the Restaurant Association has shown that in the last month that our basic costs have gone up 9%. And God help me, I'm in the crab cake business, and crab meat's up almost 100%. So I just wanted to reiterate, I'm thankful for the programs that have started, but there's so much help that's still needed out there. And we're trying to continue on, and we're trying to hang on so that we can continue to be vibrant, huge parts of our communities. And again, Senator Cardin and Congressman Sarbanes, thank you so very much for all your help.
Well, John, we appreciate Gertrude's. You do a great job there. And so thank you for staying with this. And thank you for the way that you have said this. Look, we think restaurants deserve special attention, because you were ordered by government to change your operations dramatically, and your revenues tanked as a result of it. And it's been this way now for over a year. So we do think you need this special attention. That's why we passed the Restaurant Revitalization Fund as an effort to do that. During COVID-19, over 100,000 restaurants closed their doors, despite our efforts, some permanently, most permanently. We lost over 2 million jobs in the restaurant field alone, restaurant bar field alone. So we knew we had to do something special for restaurants. And yes, we know you're not out of this pandemic yet, that we still need to pay attention. So that is why we did the Restaurant Revitalization Fund. That's why there is bipartisan support now to replenish those funds. My only hesitation is that I can never make any predictions about what Congress may or may not do. It's a highly unpredictable branch of government as far as getting bills to the finish line. In the Senate, if any one senator objects, they can slow things down for a long period of time. So we are trying to find an avenue available to replenish those funds, and we will certainly be very transparent in the manner in which we do this, because we do agree with you, you need additional help.
John, you've been on a roller coaster with many other restaurants across the country and the state, and that really, it has been a roller coaster, because we had those periods where it looked like people were going to be able to come back, you were going to be able to reopen. It was this kind of stop situation going on that created a tremendous amount of uncertainty, made it difficult for you to maintain your supply line and all the rest of it that goes into small business, particularly when you operate on very small margins. So thank you for your perspective. I come back to this idea that as we were standing up new supports and building new infrastructure to help small businesses during the crisis, we should be taking, and I think people have been taking good notes about what are the pieces of that that we have to maintain on a permanent basis, just because it works better. You know, if you set up, in this case, you've described a situation where the application, the information you got ahead of time, the application process, all the dimensions of it worked really well for you. It's just that the program ran out of money. So that's a situation where, you know, all the practical dimensions of it seem to work well. It's a matter of making sure it's properly resourced. And then again, thinking about as we move forward, what are the lessons learned to build a better system of supporting small businesses, including restaurants, in difficult times as we encounter them? Because we're going to keep encountering challenges as we move forward. There's no question about that.
Thank you, Congressman. We have time for one more brief question, and that's going to go to Mr. Andrew Pouring. Anyone that didn't get a chance to ask your question, I will put the Senator Cardin's email address in the chat, as well as Congressman Sarbanes' website. The last brief question will go to Mr. Pouring. I'll request to unmute you now. See if that worked, Mr. Pouring, if you're able to see the request to be unmuted. Second. All right, maybe some technical issues, but like I said, the information to contact our offices will be in the chat, and I'll leave it to Senator Cardin, Congressman Sarbanes, and Mr. Umberger for closing remarks.
Well, as most of you said, we're not out of COVID-19 yet. We recognize that. And even when COVID-19 is completed, we do have opportunities under the Small Business Administration to deal with challenges that small businesses face. So we want to make sure we keep a very close in touch on these issues. Believe me, these sessions are very important to us because it helps us to craft the bills that make sense for you. I do want to acknowledge also that Ron Storhoff is on the call of my staff. He is one of the ones that's in the room as they do the drafting on the small business legislation. He's on my staff and the Small Business Committee staff, and is very much interested in feedback as to how these programs are working and what additional help we can be for you. We do look forward to the American Jobs Plan. We do think we can really improve the tools under the SBA to help small businesses moving forward after we get through COVID-19. So we look forward to continuing this dialogue. And I must tell you, I have the honor of being the senior senator from Maryland, which only means I've been in the Senate longer than Chris Van Hollen. But I work very closely with all 10 members of our delegation on Team Maryland. Work closely with the governor, with our county execs and our local officials. So it is Team Maryland. And one of our key players, as I said, is John Sarbanes, who's taken so many leadership positions in so many different areas. He's going to be the centerpiece of discussion on our democracy issues, the one for the people. He has been one of the true leaders on the Chesapeake Bay and on the environment, and on a key position on commerce. He's been one of our great leaders on economic issues of facing businesses in Maryland. So, John, again, thank you for all your help.
Thank you, Senator. It was great to be able to partner and talk with small businesses today about the challenges that you face. I want to thank Steve Umberger for joining us and lending his expertise to this conversation. As the Senator said, as we look forward to the American Jobs Plan, there's going to be great opportunities there in terms of infrastructure, all that can flow from it for small businesses, provided that good information and opportunity for our smallest businesses continues to be offered. And that's always the challenge. And that's in large part what this call today has been about. But whether it's strengthening manufacturing through things like the manufacturing extension partnership or building up these incubators, innovation hubs, there's so many ideas that have found their way into the American Jobs Plan. So that's why we continue to push hard on that for the benefit of our small businesses. Let me just say this, Senator Cardin is a national leader when it comes to helping small businesses. So any information that you shared with us today is essentially straight to the source of good policy in Washington when it comes to small businesses. When I want to make a suggestion based on what I hear in the community from small businesses, to help shape national policy, I call Senator Cardin. So that's what you all had the opportunity to do today. I want to thank the senator for his incredible leadership in this space. Look forward to continuing to work with him, with Steve, and with everybody on this call. Thanks very much.
And okay, Steve,
just a couple words. I want to thank the Senator Cardin and Congressman Sarbanes. Both have been with us throughout this whole pandemic and well before that. But to all the small business owners, you all are surviving, continue to survive. Whatever we can do to help, to point you in the right direction. We do in fact have a great relationship with the Small Business Development Center Network, the SCORE Network, the Women Business Center Network, and soon to be the Veteran Business Opportunity Center Network. And if we can't answer your questions or address your concerns, we'll find the right people for you. So thank you all for being here, and thank you for the opportunity to be with you.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks. Stay safe.